Will you be my light when I cannot see? And when I can't take another step, Lord, will you carry me? And when I've lost my fight, will you be my strength? Will you set me a table in the presence of my enemies? I shall not want. I shall not want. Oh, my soul's got a shepherd in the valley, and I shall not want. I shall not want. I shall not want. Cause my cup's running over, and I shall not want. And I will lift my eyes to where my help comes from. And I won't be afraid of the shadow, cause I've seen the sun. No, I will not stop when the way gets hard. Cause the green only grows in the valley, and that's where you are. Say, I shall not walk. No, no, I shall not walk. Hey, no, my soul's got a shepherd.
right. Good morning, good morning. Let's stand and worship together. The creation suddenly articulate with a thousand tongues to lift one cry from the north to south and east to west. We hear Christ be magnified. Were the whole earth echoing his eminence, his name would burst from sea and sky. From the rivers to the mountaintops, we hear Christ be magnified. Oh, Christ be magnified. Let his praise arise. Christ be magnified in me. Oh, Christ be magnified from the altar of my life. Christ be magnified in me. Every creature finds its inmost melody, and every
church this morning. We're going to continue to worship together, but first, find a hand to shake around you, find a hug, find someone that you have wanted to meet for a while and you haven't quite met them yet. Go cross the room, find someone who needs that interaction, And we're going to continue to worship together this morning.
Is under fire. Another way when the walls are closing in. And when I look at the space between where I used to be and this reckoning, I know I will never be alone. There was another in the fire standing next to me. There was another in the waters, holding back the seas. And should I ever need reminded of how I've been set free, there is a cross that bears the burden, where another died for me. There is another in the fire.
How's everyone doing this morning? Amen. If you would turn your Bibles with me to Mark 15, and we're going to start at verse 16. And the soldiers led him away inside the palace, that is the governor's headquarters.
And they called together the whole battalion, and they clothed him in a purple cloak, and twisted together a crown of thorns they put on him. And they began to salute him, "Hail, King of the Jews." And they were striking his head with a reed and spitting on him and kneeling down in homage to him. And they mocked him. They stripped him of the purple cloak and put his crown of, and put his own clothes on him. And they led him out to crucify him. If you would, take the bread with me. Before we take this bread, let's pray real quick. Father, we thank you for the body of Christ, Lord, that was broken on the cross for our behalf, Lord. Lord, that you lead us in remembrance of this each and every day, Lord, as we go about our lives, in our jobs, in our families, in our neighborhoods. God, Lord, when we go grocery shopping, that we are reminded of the body that was broken for us on that cross. In Jesus' name, amen. Take the body. Would you get your juice ready? Just spilled a little blood on the ground. Pray with me real quick. Lord, thank you for this day, for the blood that was spilled for us on the cross, Lord, that we know that hope is in you and you alone, Lord, that salvation belongs to you. Lord, you defeated death on that cross, Lord. You defeated the bondage of sin, God. Lord, you made a way for us through your Son, Jesus Christ, to be made whole with you, God. Lord, that we trust in that and that we remember that. Praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Father, in everything that we do, that we give honor to you, God. In our worship, Lord, when we're doing what we find the most joy in, Lord, when we may be driving down the road, Lord, that we remember that it is because of you that we have hope and salvation. Lord, that we take that serious, Lord, and that we proclaim that boldly to those who may need to hear it, God. Praise in Jesus' name. Amen.
Finished work on the cross for us. Hebrews 13 says that now all we are asked of God to give is a sacrifice of praise. So would you stand with me and let's with our mouth, with our soul, praise the Lord.
Yeah. You know what also is sweet, if you're a Rangers fan, is beating the Astros. So I was at the game last night, and if you were watching it, you may remember we're down 2-1, get a hit. Josh Smith is coming around third. There's going to be a play at the plate. And everybody in the stands, it's a packed house last night, everybody in the stands is sitting here and they're starting to do this, like they're surfing. They're going to see what is about to happen at the plate, including me. And I was about center right, so my body has shifted just like this, and I'm raising up. I'm ready to see this play at the plate. Now, a few minutes earlier, the woman that was sitting right in front of me had gone to go get some food for her family. And she's starting to come down the stairs while all this is unfolding. And she has a whole bunch of hot dogs in her right hand and a big old thing of nachos in her left hand. And as Josh Smith crosses the plate, I go, "Safe!" And those nachos, man, if there was a runner going to first, I would have had him out, because those nachos went flying all over my shoes. My hand smelled like stadium nacho cheese, which isn't even cheese if you read the ingredients. For like 8 hours, it smelled. I was like at night. It was like waking me up at night. It was so nasty, and it just got over all sorts of things. Well, and she was really gracious. Obviously, I got her a whole nother thing of nachos, and. But what was happening is I had tunnel vision, right? I was so focused on one thing that I wasn't paying attention to everything else around me. And men, listen to me. We get tunnel vision quite often. And we go about life focused on just one or two things, and we don't pay attention to the things around us, and it stunts our growth. One of the things you've heard me talk about it over the last couple of weeks is Better Man. And tonight we kick that off at the Levitt at 6 o'clock. And bring a lawn chair,
You may be on the fence whether or not you want to participate in the small group. We got a bunch of guys that are going to be meeting small group on Wednesday nights at 7 here in the fellowship hall. But you may go, I just want to taste what this will be like. And let me invite you tonight to the Levitt, better man, bring a lawn chair, expand your vision for what it means to be a biblical man. Okay? Okay. Jesus, thank you. Thanks for the time of music and worship that we had. Thank you for your word. Now, would you give us a posture of learning toward your word? Lord, I know that there's nothing helpful that can come out of my mouth if it's not empowered by you. And so, Spirit, would you do what only you can do? In Jesus' name, amen. I'm pretty certain that you and I share, we can identify in this way, that you have lost friends, you've lost loved ones, you've maybe experienced some pain, suffering. You know, it hits everybody at some point in life. And if it hasn't hit you in a significant way, then we just haven't lived long enough. But suffering and pain is something that hits all of us. And what's funny about it is that some people who live exemplary lives experience it differently than other people who maybe don't taste it in the same way. And it can be frustrating. You know, you start questioning, how do you even just reconcile suffering, whether that's physical or emotional or relational? And we know that there's some things in life that, man, we are just not going to have an explanation for until we get to heaven, right? But, you know, would it be true that God uses suffering in a sense to shape us, to evaluate us? It says in Hebrews 12:6 that he disciplines those that he loves. Is it true that God sometimes uses suffering in order to magnify himself? I mean, generally speaking, we know that all suffering is a result of this pervasive brokenness that began in the garden. We know that sometimes suffering is consequential. You know, if we do this, then there's that. But are we comfortable with the idea that God appoints suffering? Does it make you uncomfortable to think that maybe he's behind some of it, or allows it, rather? So that's what I want us to kind of wrestle with this morning a little bit. We're going to go through John chapter 9, the whole chapter. So if you have your Bibles, I'm going to turn to John chapter 9. And here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to walk through that entire chapter with you. And there's just so much there. But we're going to kind of circle back around, kind of like Paul writes. He starts off with kind of a theme, and then he kind of goes all the way around, and he comes back. But the gospel writer John wrote this, and here's what's happening. If you remember a few weeks ago when we were in the book of John, chapter 7, the Feast of Tabernacles, or the booths, had started, and they were having a water ceremony. And they would go to the pool of Siloam, and they would draw water out of that pool, and they would take it to the altar, and they would pour it over the altar as a symbol of purifying the altar. And there in chapter 7, we see Jesus, and he says, hey, listen, I'm the living water. I'm the living water. He's making this messianic statement, this expression. And then in chapter 8, as the Feast of Tabernacles and Booths continues, you have the lamp ceremony, the ceremony of lights. And Jesus again makes a statement, a messianic statement, and he says, I am the light of the world. And now you're going to see both of those statements represented here in chapter 9. So he's walking out of the temple at this point. Pharisees, Sadducees, they want to kill him. And here's where he is in chapter 9, verse 1. And I'm just going to take a couple passages and we'll talk about them and then we'll go back and work through the whole thing. As he passed by, he saw a man blind from birth. And his disciples asked him, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?" And Jesus answered, "It was not that this man sinned or his parents, but that the works of God might be displayed in him. We must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. Night is coming when no one can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world." Having said these things, he spit on the ground and made mud with his saliva. Then he anointed the man's eyes with the mud and said to him, "Go wash in the pool of Siloam," which means sent. So he went and washed, and he came back seeing. So I love this. I mean, it just starts off, you know, he's leaving the temple. And listen, Jesus had a lot of things to do, right? I mean, he was the busiest man ever, yet he was never in a hurry, which was a really sweet deal. And he sees this blind man. And what's going to be evident as we continue to read is that the other religious people, they never saw him. They didn't pay attention to this blind man who would have been begging. Now, here's what we know is that the blindness that this man had, it was absolutely a physical ailment that Jesus was going to address, okay? But what is also true in this passage is that blindness is a picture of our condition, a human condition, when we are apart from Christ, okay? So here's what happens. The disciples say, "Hey, Jesus, Rabbi, who sinned? Teacher, who sinned? Was it this man? Was it his parents? You know, was it something generational? Why is he blind?" And they're just assuming, because Jewish thought connected suffering with sin. So they're assuming that if somebody was suffering, it had to be because of some form of sin or generational sin that was connected to that. But here's what I love. Jesus never objectifies this man. He doesn't look at him and immediately think that. You know, he doesn't assume that there is a sin story behind the circumstance of this man. Now, what a great lesson just right there for us. How often sometimes we see somebody, whether it's an ailment or something else, and we just assume certain things based on the way they appear. But Jesus says it's not because of sin. Now, no, that's not Jesus making a blanket generalized statement. He's not saying that there, consequences don't play a role into sin. He's just saying in this case, that's not the case. Like, it's not this man or his parents. I mean, we know that there are consequences that lead to sin, right? I mean, that's the story, or at least Job's friends were trying to get Job to buy into. But we also know that that's true just in life. When we were in the adoption process, it was a long process for us. We actually had a young boy named LJ. And he was actually living with us for a time. We thought we were going to adopt LJ. He had fetal alcohol syndrome. Fetal alcohol syndrome was a result of his birth mother not being responsible with substances while she was pregnant. There was consequences to that. There's consequences. But Jesus here is saying, in this case, his blindness is not a result of his sin or even his parents' sin. And, you know, just a note, we need to be really, really careful that we don't place judgment on things that we don't have context for. In fact, in a lot of cases, when we don't have context, we just need to leave the cause and effect to the one who causes and affects all things, right? Who is sovereign. We need to be careful making generalized statements about sin and the consequences and as it relates to suffering. But again, here's what Jesus says about this man. His blindness is not a result of sin. His blindness is so that the works of God may be displayed in him. so that the works of God may be displayed in him. And he goes on in verse 5, and he reminds them, I am the light of the world. Now, I'm going to come back to this and kind of what it's being implied right there. But let me keep moving. And then, and you're probably looking at this going, man, that is weird. Why would he spit on the ground, make mud? And it says that he anointed his eyes. Well, there's all sorts of different theories out about that. In one case, you know, saliva was and mud was medicinal contextually and culturally. Some would say it's symbolic for going back to the creation of man. But here's what we know, is that when he spit and made mud and wiped it on his eyes and told him to go wash in the pool of Siloam, that he was healed. He was healed. Now, this was a messianic act that was taking place. Two things that were messianic about what was happening here. One is that it was the Sabbath, and you're not allowed to spit and make mud on the Sabbath. Now, you may be thinking, was that really written? It was. Yeah. Now, understand this. When the Jewish religious leaders were trying to protect the Sabbath day, I think they had really good intentions on protecting people from working and honoring the Sabbath. Now, it got really blown out of proportion to where now you're not allowed to spit and make mud, which means you couldn't play baseball on the Sabbath, right? So by Jesus doing that, I mean, he is legitimately and intentionally not only breaking the Sabbath, but he's making a statement about who he is. He's violating Pharisaic law, and he's saying, listen, I'm not bound by those laws. I mean, he's the Lord of the Sabbath, right? But we also see him making another messianic statement by directing the man to the pool of Siloam. Again, this was during the Feast of Tabernacles where they saw healing power in that. And so when he has this man go and wipe his muddy eyes with the water from the pool of Siloam, you know, he's making the statement and pronouncing healing not from the waters, not from the tradition behind it, but he himself. He is the healer. He is the healer. So this guy gets healed. I mean, he sees for the first time. I had LASIK surgery, and for 15 minutes, I couldn't see. That was a weird feeling. I can't imagine not being able to see. And then all of a sudden, like, you see color and all these things that you'd been listening to and hearing and the birds chirping, and now you're seeing them actually fly. I mean, what an amazing thought, right? Look at verse 8. The neighbors and those who had seen him before as a beggar were saying, is this not the man who used to sit and beg? And some said, it is he. And others said, no, but he is like him. He kept saying, I am the man. So they said to him, then how are your eyes open? And he answered, the man called Jesus made mud and anointed my eyes and said to me, go to Siloam and wash. So I went and washed and received my sight. And they said to him, well, where is he? And he said, I don't know. So some questioning starts. His neighbors are going, you know, is this the guy? And the guy you said who healed you, like, where's he at now? Let's keep reading. Look at verse 13. They brought to the Pharisees the man who had formerly been blind. Now it was a Sabbath day when Jesus had made mud and opened his eyes. So the Pharisees again asked him how he had received his sight. And he said to them, he put mud on my eyes and I washed and I see. Some of the Pharisees said, this man is not from God, for he does not keep the Sabbath. But others said, how can a man who is a sinner do such signs? And there was a division among them, so they said again to the blind man, what do you say about him since he has opened your eyes? And he said, he is a prophet. So the neighbors, they don't have answers to this. They take him to the Pharisees. The Pharisees question him. The man explains what happened. Now, by the way, the Pharisees would have been pretty standoffish to this man because religious leaders would have thought that because he was blind, he was cursed, so that he was dirty. He couldn't be touched. And so they from their cultural tradition. I mean, they had some concerns. And then they say, man, there's no way that this guy could be, you know, the Messiah because he was working on the Sabbath. He was spitting in mud and healing on the Sabbath. Now, by the way, by Jesus working this work on the Sabbath, he's not eliminating the value of the Sabbath, okay? He's just the Lord of it. In fact, the Sabbath is still something that we ought to keep. We ought to practice. In fact, just, you know, here's a few reasons why. I mean, one, God wants us to be healthy. Like, rest is healthy. I mean, he modeled this at creation. Work 6 days, rest one. He longs for us to be healthy and well. Secondly, he wants us to recognize where rest comes from and even how work is produced. Like, he is the giver of all good things. He is the Lord of rest, and he is the Lord of production. But lastly, you know, the Sabbath is a reminder of just who he is. I mean, he is God, and we are not. Like, he accomplishes things. The world does not stop when we do. He is the Lord of the Sabbath. In fact, we see three times in the gospel where Gospels where Jesus tells those around him that he is the one who orders the Sabbath. He is the one who creates. He is the one who brings rest. He is the one who brings production. So he's not getting rid of the Sabbath by this messianic statement and expression that he's making. But he is saying it's to be centered around me, not around a tradition. Well, look at verse 18. It says, the Jews did not believe that he had been blind and had received a sight until they called the parents of the man who had received a sight and asked them, is this your son who you say was born blind? How does he now see? And his parents answered, we know that this is our son and that he was born blind, but how he now sees, we do not know, nor do we know who opened his eyes. Ask him. He is of age, and he will speak for himself. His parents said these things because they feared the Jews, for the Jews had already agreed that if anyone should confess Jesus to be Christ, he was to be put out of the synagogue, and therefore his parents said, he is of age, ask him. Man, what a bummer, right? Like, you would think of all the people that would be ready to celebrate, it'd be your parents, right? And they're so dodgy right here. And instead of counting the blessing of their son being healed, now they're counting the cost of being kicked out of the synagogue. Now, I don't want to shortchange that. That would have been a big deal. I mean, that is far worse than growing up, you know, as a Texan and being a Texan and getting kicked out of Texas, okay? Like, if you're kicked out of the synagogue, like, you lose everything. Everything. I mean, you become lower than a street vendor, okay, in that culture. And so there was something that they feared, and there was a legitimate thing to fear. But can you imagine being this young man who hadn't seen all of his life? He now sees and is healed, and the people that raised him are just like, I don't know. They're standoffish. Ask him, he's of age. They're distancing themselves from their son. Look at verses 23 or 24. So for the second time, they called the man who had been blind and said to him, give glory to God. We know that this man is a sinner. And he answered, whether he is a sinner, I do not know. One thing I do know is that though I was blind, now I see. They said to him, what did he do to you? How did he open your eyes? And he answered them, I have told you already, and you would not listen. Why do you want to hear it again? Do you also want to become his disciples? I love that, man. He gets a little preachy right here. Like, and they reviled him, saying, you are his disciple, but we are the disciples of Moses. We know that God has spoken to Moses, but as for this man, we do not know where he comes from. The man answered, why? This is an amazing thing. You do not know where he comes from, and yet he opened my eyes. We know that God does not listen to sinners, but if anyone is a worshiper of God and does his will, God listens to him. Never since the world began has it been heard that anyone opened the eyes of a man born blind. If this man were not from God, he could do nothing. And they answered him, you were born in utter sin, and would you teach us? And they cast him out. Man, the guy preaches back to them again. Testimony, guys. Man, if God's done something in your life, it cannot be refuted. Here's the guy who says, one thing I know is I was once blind, now I can see. And look at how this ends in verse 35. Jesus heard, check this out. Jesus heard that they had cast him out, and having found him, he said, do you believe in the Son of Man? And he answered, and who is he, sir, that I may believe in him? And Jesus said to him, you have seen him, and it is he who is speaking to you. And he said, Lord, I believe. And he worshiped him. Jesus said, for judgment I came into this world, but those who do not see may see, and those who see may become blind. Some of the Pharisees near him heard these things and said to him, are we also blind? And Jesus said to them, if you were blind, you would have no guilt. But now that you say we see, your guilt remains. Man, one thing I love here, again, this guy, his parents were dodgy. His neighbors and the people that had been around him didn't believe him. The Pharisees were, you know, throwing emotional and spiritual stones at him. It says Jesus heard, and he went to go find the guy. Man, isn't that true? Isn't that just like Jesus? But here's kind of the summary of this. If you're a Pharisee, is that there's more hope for a fool than a man wise in his own eyes. There's more hope for a fool than a man who is wise in his own eyes. See, the Pharisees admitted that they could see, but they rejected the evidence of what they could see in Jesus, and as a result of rejecting the evidence, they were guilty. Listen, the gospel brings about different reactions from different kinds of hearts. Here we have a blind sinner who receives the truth and sees, and we have a self-righteous religious person who rejects the truth and becomes even more blind spiritually. So what are some takeaways this morning? That was my introduction, by the way. First thing, I've already said this, it's a great reminder, and it's real simple, Jesus sees you. Jesus sees you. Verse 1 opens up that he sees the man blind. Busy, not hurried, walking out of the temple courts, and he sees the man who's in need. And just like he sees the man who's in need, just like he found the man who'd been ridiculed, he sees you. He finds you. What's also true is that Jesus is seen in you. Jesus is seen in you. That was evident in what had happened, that what God had done in this blind man, the other folks, that they could see the evidence of that, but they were really uncomfortable with that. But they saw. They saw. But what's also true, I mean, if you go back to look at verse 5, verse 4, it says, we must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. Night is coming when no one can work. And verse 5 says, as long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. Here's the implication of that, is that wherever Jesus is in that life, he is illuminating that life. Where Jesus is the cosmic Lord who is working mysteriously all over the world, his light is illuminated in you. I mean, that's the point of what he was saying in Matthew chapter 5, 14 and 16, right? 14 through 16 is you are the light of the world. A city cannot, on a hill, cannot be hidden. Man, he wants to illuminate himself in you. I mean, that was happening, right? The guy says, one thing I know is I was blind, but now I see. Now, here's what I want us to wrestle with, though, is that Jesus is sovereign in our suffering. Jesus is sovereign in our suffering. And again, back at verse 3, that initial question that is posed that got this whole thing started, his disciples say, Rabbi, who sinned? Was it the man or was it his parents? And he says, neither one. Rather, it's that the works of God might be displayed in him. Again, let's go back to that question. I mean, if we're appointing certain suffering to God, that feels kind of uncomfortable to attribute that to him, that he allows it in some way, shape, or form. And I think oftentimes because we're so uncomfortable with the idea of that, we'll do one of two things. We'll just attribute all of what is bad to Satan, which then gives us excuses like Satan made me do it, which is a dumb excuse. It's not always untrue. But that's our way of not really dealing with sin, not dealing with a fallen world. Or we just attribute it to just the general idea of brokenness in the world, which is absolutely true. We know that Satan leverages suffering. We know that we live in a broken world, but we're still left processing the question, why? We're still left, you know, asking, you know, what do we do with the suffering that we see, the suffering that we experience? I mean, I was at a store having a conversation with a guy this, you know, earlier this week, and he asked me, you know, how do you reconcile suffering and pain? Like, isn't this kind of a polemic against Christianity? And it has been for years. It's an accusation, you know, against people of faith. You know, how can you believe in a God in a world with so much evil and suffering, right? I mean, the implication is that Christians face this incongruency between their faith and unavoidable pain. But the reality is this, is that pain is pervasive for everybody. Suffering is a problem for everyone. Whoever we are, we need a perspective that helps us process the sense of suffering, and we also need the power in order to handle it. So what do we do? What do we do? What are our options? Well, let me give you a couple options. One, some people would call it the moralistic view. The moralistic view. This view is that suffering comes as a consequence of someone's action. So if we hold to the moralistic view all the time, then we would think that, you know, it's caused by people and therefore that it can also be avoided. And again, this is kind of probably the oldest and most common one. It's the perspective, again, that was offered by Job's friends. You know, Job, you must have committed some type of sin. That's why your children died, your property was destroyed, and now you're afflicted with disease. By the way, that's essentially the Hindu idea of karma. And again, that's not to say that our consequences aren't tied to our choices sometimes, but that's way too simplistic to just attribute that all the time. It fails to address disasters like tsunamis and hurricanes. It fails to account for the random ways that one person suffers and another person doesn't, that some people are healed and die of the same disease, even if they've taken the same treatment, prayed the same prayers, not to mention just the guilt that is poured onto people who are suffering through things that are really, really hard when we say, well, you're obviously the problem. Moralistic view fails. Then you have the life is difficult view. As if to say that if we just accept the situation, it won't be so hard. If we'll just accept pain as part of life, then it will begin to alleviate the pain. We reframe our situation, and if we can reframe it, then we'll transcend it, right? Now, to some degree, that can be helpful in changing our perspective, but reframing it only goes so far. I mean, some suffering is bad regardless of how we perceive it or not. And the effort to try to just change our thinking would lead to harmful denials of reality, and one, it's just super naive to try to reframe it. Then you have the evolutionary view. It says that the reality of evil and suffering is one of the strongest arguments against God. Richard Dawkins, who is the primary person who's expressed this perspective, here's what he says. This is super encouraging. In a universe of blind forces and genetic replication, some people are going to get hurt, other people are going to get lucky, and you won't find any rhyme or reason in it, nor any justice. Well, that helps me sleep better at night. Listen, I mean, that view doesn't lead to anything more than anger and frustration. It's helpless and hopeless. And gosh, in the realm of those how questions, I mean, the view, that particular view fails catastrophically. It offers no resources to help people handle disease, disaster, or death. And it leaves people ill-equipped to support others going through trials and find strength for themselves to resist the despair and face the realities of real suffering. But then there's a redemptive view. This is the biblical view. And the redemptive view said that the world isn't as it is supposed to be. In fact, suffering is an outrage, but it can be redemptive. It points to an afterlife where pain and suffering will finally be defeated. I mean, the Bible teaches us that a personal God created the world and pronounced all of his creation, including people, good. He gave people the dignity of choice to obey his commands or reject them. And even the first people, as well as everybody else since, have chose to some degree disobedience or rebellion against God. And the world's been a wreck ever since that. Yet, the Bible reminds us that God has begun a work of redemption. He's begun a work of redemption that can extend to an individual people for all eternity. And while life includes suffering, there's an eternal afterlife free of pain offered for those who trust in God. Now, some of you are sitting there going, well, that's great news once I get on the other side. Okay? So what do we do now? What do we do now? Israel is one of my favorite places to go. As you can imagine, I've been multiple times. When you go to Israel, if you have a tour guide, inevitably the tour guide is going to take you to these little places off the beaten path that he has set up with other vendors, to where you're going to go buy olive wood or little trinkets or all sorts of little things. And whether you want to stop or not, whether you need to go to the bathroom or you're hungry or not, like, you're stopping, okay? Well, one place that a number of years ago that we went to that I really loved was an olive oil factory. An olive oil factory. Some of you may have been there. And it was just amazing to hear about about the olive tree. And how it's produced. You know, olive tree takes about 40 years to mature, long process of growth. Olive tree needs to be pruned regularly, whether that is through natural conditions or intentional ones. Because if it becomes a wild olive, the fruit becomes very bitter. So there has to be a pruning that takes place. In fact, if it's not pruned, either naturally or intentionally, it will take about 10 years to be restored to sweet fruit. But here's some things that I learned from that experience. One is this, is olive trees don't produce fruit if the tree doesn't experience the harsh winds of the east and the fresh winds of the west. Let me say it again. Olive trees don't produce fruit if the tree doesn't experience the harsh winds of the east and the fresh winds of the west. Here's the point. is pruning is necessary for growth. We don't always like to hear that. But pruning is necessary. Crisis produces growth. And here's what happens with the olive tree, is that it is leaning into those harsh winds of the east and receiving the fresh winds of the west. Its roots are getting deeper. And here's what's unique. The deeper the roots, the sweeter the oil. The shallower the roots, the more bitter the oil. Think about that from your perspective of suffering. What I also learned is this, is once the olive tree has produced the fruit, it's not useful until it is without hardness and bitterness. Painful experiences soften us. Painful experiences soften us. I had a short period of time where I had chronic pain, but what I would tell you is having that chronic pain for a time, which was very minimal, it just gave me some humility and some empathy for people who experience chronic pain all the time. I can't even imagine that. It softens us when we experience suffering. You guys have heard me talk about one of my best friends growing up, 16-year-old David. David died suddenly when we were in high school. Man, that was a major point in my life. What you haven't heard me talk about very often. So his parents and I became really, really close. In fact, I still hand out a scholarship on a regular basis in his name. And we visit them when we're in New Mexico and other things. Great family. About 8 years later, their second oldest child, Rebecca, was killed in a car accident driving from Tech to DFW. They lost their two oldest kids. Now, if you read statistics on this, when a family loses one child, oftentimes the marriage doesn't make. When they lose two children, it almost never makes. And here's what I could tell you about the Mask family today. Is the pain that they experienced has produced such a humility and empathy in them that they are an incredible voice of Jesus as they speak into the lives of other people that have experienced that type of hurt. Then they went and adopted three more kids. Then they started a private school for children. Painful experiences soften us. We grow in humility and empathy. Third thing is this, the crushing of the olive cores produces a cleansing agent for our body. One of the questions on the tour group was, well, what do you do with the olive cores? And so the tour guide came and he dropped some crushed olive cores in our hands and he said, just wipe them like you would soap. And you would have thought that my skin was going to fall off. It became so clean and dry and purified. The crushing in crisis or suffering leads to a purity unknown to those who haven't been tested. There's something so healthy about rubbing your hands by experiencing the crushing of life. Please hear me, man. I hesitate. Messages like this, like folks don't want to hear this because they think that I don't want you to hear flippancy. I want you to hear purpose. I want you to hear how God uses these circumstances and crises in our life. Last thing is this, is that the most valuable part of the olive tree is not the olive, but it's the oil that comes from it because the oil produces light. Hard crushing produces light. That's what was happening in verse 3. again, why is this man blind? And Jesus says, so that the works of God may be displayed. That the works of God may be displayed. I was reminded yesterday of something you've heard me quote a bunch, actually, but it reminded me of Joni Erickson Tada. When she was 17 years old, she jumped into the Chesapeake Bay and didn't understand how shallow it was at the time, and she broke her vertebra, and she became a quadriplegic. Now, most of us, whether we recognize that name or not, we've probably all heard something she's written, read a book that she's written, or been influenced by this woman in some way, shape, or form. But here's what she says, is that sometimes God allows the things that he hates in order to accomplish the things that he loves. Sometimes he allows the things that he hates in order to accomplish the things that he loves. And Jesus is intentional. He is purposeful. He sees you. And he moves in you, even in the harshest of circumstances. Pray with me. Jesus, thank you for your word. I know that there are things that oftentimes we just want to skip or not to think about or to maybe design our own thoughts and theology around. And yet, thank you for, even with not having all the answers to suffering, speaking into it in such a way that allows us to rest and know that you have always been sovereign. Sovereign in our pain, sovereign in our suffering. Lord, we also look with great hope for those that have suffered deeply, emotionally, physically, relationally. We're grateful that when you talk about hope, you're talking about a promise that has already been fulfilled in the future, even though we're living in the present. So Lord, thank you for eternity in a restored new state. In your holy and your precious name, amen. Let me invite you to stand. Our staff is going to be here. If you'd like to pray with one of our staff members, I would invite you to come and move quickly and do that. If you would like to have a conversation about what it looks like to know King Jesus, we would love to talk with you as well. Would you move?
Song is forever yours. A thousand
with a thousand hallelujahs, we magnify your name. You alone deserve the glory, the honor, and the praise. Lord Jesus, this song is forever.
Gospel is centered on God's generosity towards us. He sent his son Jesus as a free gift we did not deserve. When you give to Lake Church, you're expressing that gospel-centered generosity, and you are a part of a greater kingdom work that can only be done together. Here is one of the ways your generosity is making an impact through Lake Church.
Hi, my name is Richard Biesecker, and I'm a part of the production ministry here at Lake Church. When you give to Lake Church, you allow us to change the light bulbs in the worship center to help it keep us bright on the Sunday morning and throughout the week. Thank you guys so much.
There are a number of ways you can give to Lake Church. One is through our online giving platform. You can go to our app, you can mail it in, or you can drop it off physically on a Sunday morning or during the week.
And one thing I know about Richard Biesecker is that is one brave dude. Because I've been up in the catwalk up here, and he was in one of these three, and I don't trust it. Man, he is such a good guy. If you're interested in learning more about Lake Church and becoming part of Lake Church, we have a lunch that is following the second service called Starting Point, and it is in the fellowship hall. If you go all the way down this hallway, and down the stairwell, you're going to be able to see it. You'll see the signage and everything. We would love for you to come and be a part of that. It's a free lunch. You get to spend some time with the staff, get to know some of the staff, and nobody's forcing anybody to sign anything on the dotted line. There's no secret handshakes or tattoos or anything like that. Just an opportunity for you to get to know who we are as a staff. And so let me invite you to that. And then let me also call us to a vote. So our personnel team has been walking through the process of initially looking for an executive pastor. And through that process, plus some other movement within staff, we're bringing a couple candidates to you today out of that process. And then we're also taking the interim tag off of Tommy Foster, that when he came in June, and he has just served so beautifully and brilliantly, and back in December, the personnel team said, man, we need to take that interim tag off. And we just haven't gotten around to a vote officially to do that yet. But know this, is that our personnel team has unanimously brought these candidates, all three of these candidates, before you. They have vetted them fully, referenced, gotten to know them really well. Our staff has gotten to know them. And we are deeply excited about the opportunity to present them to you this morning. So one of those, as I said, is Tommy Foster, where we are taking the interim tag off, and he would be continue to be full-time without the interim tag. One is Jared Scott, who will become the discipleship pastor. So this is Hannah Morris's last Sunday, and we're going to pray for her here in a second. She's transitioning to another church, and we're excited for her and going to commission her here in a second. But Jared will come in and assume those responsibilities plus some other responsibilities as well. And then Olis Murinuk, and Olis will be coming as our administrative and community engagement pastor, overseeing all of the operational side and strategic development. So grateful for our personnel team as they have done the hard work of bringing these candidates to us. And since it's coming from our personnel team, it doesn't require a second, just a vote. And so here's how that can happen this morning. So, and if you're not sitting on the front pew or front chairs, and you're going to have a QR code on a seat in front of you. They're staggered. So one of the ways you can vote is pull your phone out to the camera and put that camera right there in that QR code, and a little yellow box is going to come up, or you can do it up here and you just hit that and it takes you to a voting link, or you can check your email. If you're a church member, then you received an email at 10 a.m. this morning where you can click that link and you can vote too. Or if you don't like technology at all and don't want to do that, when you walk out the door, our ushers will have a paper ballot and you can fill that out and drop it into the offering plate. Also. So those are three voting options. Want to make sure that you have the ability to do that. So as you are clicking those codes, let me invite Hannah Morris up here. And here, I'll come down. And let me pray over her. We're excited for her. She has been a blessing to Lake Church. She was one of our college students. Then she went away for a while. I had the joy of being able to marry her and her husband, Jackson, and then she has been back for, what, 5, 6 years? And you've had multiple roles, and we're excited this new season of life for you, and you'll be deeply missed, but we're grateful. It's also her birthday, so I was going to bust out with a happy birthday to you, but we're just going to pray instead, okay? So. All right. Pray with me. Jesus, thank you so much for, thanks for how you send great people to Lake Church. And we're really grateful for the way that you do that consistently. Thank you for these candidates that are coming in. Lord, thank you for Hannah, who has served diligently and thoughtfully and is now commissioning out. And we are grateful for the stewardship that you've given us over her life and the stewardship that she exercised over us while she was here. Lord, would you bless her in immense ways? In your holy and precious name, amen. All right. Have a great Sunday. All right.
Song of ages to the land. Your name is the highest. Your name is the greatest. Your name stands above them all. All thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name. Cry.